welcome to the magic of Disney animation. It's a little before dawn. Well, what are we doing outside the animation building at a little before dawn? Well, we're here today to make a training film for you, our host and hostesses, to give you an in-depth introduction into the art of animation. We're going to take you through the building, introduce you to a lot of the people who've created the tour side. Then we're going to take you on the other side of the glass and let the artists explain their roles. This is going to be done in the hope that you, our hosts and hostesses, can become experts in the art of animation. But when our guests have questions as they come through the building, you'll be able to answer them. So come on, let's start the show. This is the first stop for our guests as they visit the animation studio, our lobby. This studio represents the past, present, and future of Disney Animation. And in this particular area, the lobby, really represents the past, our glorious past in many ways. It epitomizes the classic artwork that we have done through our history. I'd like to introduce you to Kay Saltz, who is from our Animation Research Library in California. Kay has been responsible for selecting a lot of the artwork that you see displayed. She also works on selecting new artwork for different exhibits, as it is our intention to change out this area every few months.
When we decided to open up a studio here in Florida, we decided to take advantage of a unique opportunity, and that opportunity was to display some of our original animation art. Animation art's been exhibited in museums all around the world, but never so much in one place as we have here. We thought that it would be a good experience for the guests to take a look at a lot of artwork that's not ordinarily reproduced or exhibited anywhere else that really shows them what the animation process is about. We're showing concept and inspirational art, for example. These are oftentimes sketches, pastels, or watercolors that are created in the very early stages, the development stages of a film, that are inspirational to the animators. They might suggest character, they might suggest costumes or color, for example. We are also showing drawings, rough animation and cleanup to show the stages of the animation process as well. We'll also be showing these study models. Study models are used by the animators to maintain character consistency and in order to view the character from all different angles. Over the years, we've come to appreciate the artistry of this artwork. We also show layouts and backgrounds. Layouts set the stage for the action and the character's movement in the film. And the backgrounds are the backgrounds in which the characters play out their action. The characters are painted on cells, and the cells are laid over the backgrounds. And these images of cells and backgrounds are also included in the exhibit. Willy the Giant is a good example of how a cell and background are combined in a clever way. Willy's head is a cell. His body is a background. The only thing that's animated in this image is just Willy's face. So that by going through the lobby exhibit, the guest gets a sense of what the animation process is all about from start to finish.
Well, well, one of Peter Pan's little lost boys.
No, wait, Hook. I can explain. I didn't want to bother you, see? There was Walter Cronkite and Storyboard.
Here we are in Theater One. This is the home of the Walter Cronkite and Robin Williams film Back to Neverland. When we were putting together the tour, we had to come up with a way of telling the guests all about animation, explaining the process to them before they actually got into the production area. You can imagine this was a very difficult film or idea to select. How do you tell the animation story? How do you make it stimulating and interesting, but at the same time, entertaining? So here, we set about trying to create a film that would do just that.
Is this Neverland? I mean, these books are huge, and me without my Cliff Notes.
This is where animation begins, with a good story, adventure, romance, humor.
Robin Williams, Mr. Left Brain. Walter Cronkite, Mr. Right Brain. When you put those two together, it's like putting together two opposite terminals in a battery. You know that you're going to get sparks and magic, and it brings an energy level of magic and fun that you just couldn't get with any other combination. It's obvious. It's perfect. We had a great communicator to base some of our work on. We went back to the old shows in which Walt Disney explained animation. Disney had a way of in a very few simple words and images, saying extremely complex things. So we studied the way the master did it and used as much from him as we possibly could, and then we just filled in the blanks with some of the new material.
This is the camera department.
What do you think? Let's lose the part with the crocodile! Walter, please!
Well, sir, pardon me. You, sir, there.
Yes, sir.
Could you give us a little help today?
Oh, yes, sir.
Well, wait a minute, you're Walter Cronkite, and that's the way it is. Hold on, Walter, can you just a moment?
When we first see Robin Williams, quite unexpectedly, it's the first time that we've introduced humour into the tour, and that was a very deliberate step. We wanted to create a formal atmosphere for the beginning of the tour so that we could make a fantastic, funny moment when Robin first turns into camera. So it's very important that our host and hostesses perpetuate that feeling. And we do that, of course, by not mentioning the fact that Robin appears in the film.
Look, Walter, you finish up with the tour. I'll catch up with the next group, okay?
Now, Robin.
Hey, wait for me, Peter!
And that's the way it is.
Come on, everybody. Here we go!
We're now in the production tour corridor. Let's just stop for a minute and just think about what a unique place this is. Let's think that there are artists working on the other side of the glass who are going to be watched 7 days a week, 9 hours a day, by the literally thousands of guests who come through here. That's a unique experience for the guests, and it's also a unique experience for our artists. When we were planning the studio tour, we felt that if we could create a real working studio, that in turn would create a really marvelous experience for our guests. As you can see behind me, there's very little activity at the moment, but it's still early in the morning. A little later, you'll see that this is a real hub of activity.
Good morning. Could you please sign in?
Our approach to producing Disney feature animation is one of blending artistic and technical skills. Now, the real trick is to orchestrate those skills through teamwork to make sure all of the effort put forth makes it onto the screen. Now, the person whose responsibility it is to manage the flow of our work between our over 70 artists is Tim O'Donnell, the production manager.
We've just finished the 6-minute Roger Rabbit short, and now we're working on two productions. The Prince and the Pauper starring Mickey Mouse and Rescuers Down Under. Not everyone in the studio works on the same part of a film at the same time. Each film is broken into scenes, and we don't necessarily work on the scenes in any given order. During production, these scenes are scattered throughout every area of the building, and it takes weeks, sometimes months, for a scene to go from an animator to someone in ink and paint.
The first stop on our tour is the story department. Many ideas are born here as sketches pinned up on the storyboard.
Animation starts with a script. We bring in a story team who work closely with the director and storyboard out the entire script.
One idea was that we would put the camera in the center of the room, and as the boy ran around, we would spin 360.
Once the storyboard's okayed, we go into recording sessions. We have the characters record their lines. That information is given to our editors.
Hold your fire!
We create what's called a story reel. And what that involves is you first go out and you record your actors saying the lines that are in the story. We use that to time out the storyboard drawings.
Hold your fire! Hold your fire! You.
This is really the first step where we get a chance to see what the picture's going to be like. How the gags work, how the timing works, how the story flows all together.
Okay, fellas!
With the story reel now completed, we now have a way to organize the entire film by numbering each scene and their exact running length. Then each of those scenes is broken down to the exact number of frames, 24 frames for each second of animation. This information is put onto an exposure sheet, or what is also called an X sheet, which tells the animator how many drawings to do for each scene.
Before the animator can actually animate a scene, they have to know the phonetics of where each mouth movement should fall. For example, if I want to write okay, I would go over to where okay starts. And that is okay. That's the word. We then will break down each word into its individual syllables and write them on the X sheet. So I go over to the X sheet and write that the O sound in the word OK will need to start on drawing number 47 and last for 5 frames. Then I go to the sound K, that's the K, and you would mark that on the X sheet. And the mouth would then simulate K and go over, and they would know that at that point they should be having a drawing that is simulating the word K.
Okay, fellas, fire away!
In addition to an X sheet, an animator also needs a layout drawing in order to begin animation. A layout is a line version of what will later become the painted background once the animation is completed. The layout drawing sets the stage where the character will act.
Right now I'm working on a workbook, and this is the initial stage in layout. It's here where we refine the storyboard. We get all the cutting together. We got to make sure that the film is paced right according to what's going on in the storyboard. This is an example of a workbook. This is for the rescuers.
Miss Bianca, I'm not sure it's such a good idea to fly this soon after eating.
It's their first encounter meeting Wilbur.
I'm the cat's pajamas, always running around with crazy little mamas.
So our first shot, we needed a wide shot, an establishing shot. This sets where they are so the audience is able to understand what's going on.
Look, Bernard, under new management, see Wilbur.
In the actual storyboard, there was 3 different shots here. There was a shot of the sign, there was a shot of the character's reaction, and then there was a shot of where they were looking. Make it a little more interesting, we combined all 3. We panned right from the sign, passed down the characters, and right over to their point of view of where they're going to go to meet Wilbur in the hangar here.
Oh, look, Bernard! Under new management, see Wilbur. Come on, darling, let's get a move out.
We look after a lot of the location design. The art director's involved with the overall look of the picture, and we have to follow his style. This is a real kind of a designy picture. The foliage in the picture takes on an almost unrealistic look. As you can see in some of these drawings here, that's a very set pattern. And in something like Roller Coaster, it's we've kind of copied the old 40s look of the cartoons that we did back then. We're basically a planning stage in the film. Is where everything is set up from the start, so it can get passed down through the line to the animators, to the background people.
Mostly in the head black slacks.
A very important part of the picture's design is the design of the characters themselves. And for every animated film we work on, the artists are given model sheets. These have been developed so that everyone working on the film will have the same information on how the character is to be drawn, in terms of overall design, body proportions, and small details, even costumes. Now with the completion of the model sheet, the layout, and the X sheet, the scene's ready to be handed over to the animator.
Animating isn't so tough. Watch this.
Look, my creation lives!
First thing I do is talk to the director thoroughly about what's involved in the scene, because sometimes the director has thought about the scene more than I have at the time I get the scene. And then you start to come up with your own ideas. And so when you get them down, you kind of pose it out, key poses. And if you take it to the director in that stage, it can save you a lot of time and energy and effort later on.
Captain, is this a non-stop flight to Australia?
hopefully, one of the very first things is I do is try to familiarize myself with the storyboard as much as possible, know where the scene fits into the overall sequence.
Now, boy, let's see if we can do something to refresh that rusty old memory of yours.
But my basic role as an animator is as the actor in an animated film.
Is yon Satan's rig?
I had a scene where McLeish is, he's got all these knives, and poor Cody's sitting up against this map with different, you know, landmarks of the area around, and McLeish doesn't want to hurt the boy, but he wants to, you know, as he put it, refresh that rusty old memory of yours. I had it to where he says, you know, is she on Satan's, and he kind of cocks his head over back, one last glance towards Cody.
Satan's ridge.
I look at myself as an actor primarily, an artist second, because it's the through the art that I do my performing.
Right now I'm animating Cody, a main character in Rescuers Down Under. I usually do what is known as thumbnails. It's a breakdown of the action. Let's say the character has to get up on his knees.
Frank!
I would enlarge him or base my key poses on these in doing the scene. It also helps you to, you know, figure out the layout of the scene, how to work it best, sort of explore the possibility with the character.
If we could get these long pieces of wood.
Wood, yeah, wood, good.
I mean, when you're doing scenes, what they're working on is one shot in the picture. It's very important to keep that perspective of how the overall thing flows.
Get some more stuff!
The kid's right. What are we waiting for?
It's the kangaroo that's talking in the scene, so he's the main focus of attention. The other characters are just moving and listening, so they're not really doing too much, but they have to be doing something just so they look alive.
I'm stuck!
What I do is I draw the characters that you see moving around in the film. I'll draw out the main parts in rough, how the character's moving, what he's doing, if he's talking, jumping around.
Hey, look! Krebs! Frank's out!
You want a clear statement. In other words, you want the character to express him or herself as a drawing. Not just the mouth talking, you know, and then the dialogue coming out, but the pose of the character. You should be able to tell by the posture of the character how that character's feeling at that moment.
Nice bluff, Miss B.
I wasn't bluffing. You don't know Bernard like I do. He'll never give up.
To judge how well a scene is working, the animators must constantly check their drawings at a speed of 24 frames per second. To do this, we use a video system that will record their drawings one frame at a time.
I'm shooting a scene of Bianca right now. She's in this cage, and she's saying, he'll never give up. And you can notice that there's little subtleties, like in the overlap on her scarf as she swings it. There'll be a little overlap on the scarf, a little bit of a drag, a little bit of body action, very subtle, to punch her dialogue up a little bit. Her shoulders go down a little bit when her head comes up.
He'll never give up.
This is where you first shoot your scene before it goes to film, because it's very costly to send something out to film. We have this set up here where you can instantly see your work. And if there's changes to be made, you don't have to worry about having it go to film and then come back a few days later like they had to do in the old days.
I did a sequence where Bernard is trying to propose to Bianca early in the show, and I really like the characters, and I really can identify with Bernard, so I really try to get into Bernard and put myself in that situation and feel how nervous and excited he must be trying to propose to Bianca.
You do? I mean, you really want to?
I don't think it's a matter of wanting. It's a matter of duty.
Duty? I never thought of it. Well, all right. How does next April sound to you?
It's just the believability and the sincerity in Disney animation. You know, you walk out crying or laughing or, you know, with a memory of a character or personality, and that maybe, you know, left you with a little something.
Hello! Hey! Where'd he go? Are you down here?
It's the one job that I've had in animation where you were allowed to work at your potential.
The thing is to remember that it's collective art form.
I'll get you loose.
Each animator heads up their own unit, which consists of the animator, an assistant, and an in-betweener. The general way the unit works is that the animator will create the overall action and timing with rough drawings, and the assistants and in-betweeners are responsible for creating the finished drawings that later will be directly transferred to cells. This phase of the animation process is also called cleanup animation.
There's a million drawings in a second, is that it? Got my good sign? Not that I have one.
Don't worry, Robin. The artist is simply cleaning up your lines.
It's important that the cleanup staff, no matter how many artists work on the character, draw the character so that it always looks the same, because it's those drawings that we end up Xeroxing, inking, and painting, and that will end up on the screen.
Everybody asks, how do you animators all draw the characters alike so that it doesn't look like more than one person is doing it? Well, we don't. And that's where the assistant comes in. It's their job to make sure that all of the characters are consistent throughout the picture.
Right, get the keys.
A lot of people wonder why we flip the drawings, and we flip them so that we can do the drawing in between the other two drawings.
I'm constantly comparing my drawings with the other two drawings, paying particular attention to shape and volume, and making sure that the movement is natural and not awkward.
The stuff you see on the screen, it's really amazing because, you know, I do a bunch of rough stuff like this. And they create a very beautiful, very precise piece of art.
Okay, anything you say, Mama Dearest.
I'm an assistant animator. Basically, the words sum up what you do, really. You assist the animator in any way you can. Animation requires teamwork, a lot of teamwork, which is a kind of a difficult request for artists, because I think they quite often like to sort of do something without people knowing about it and then present it to them. While if you're working in animation, you have to share your information and all work together to get the best result.
Whereas the animator is more concentrated on timing the character's actions and posing the character, the key assistant will then take his drawings and make sure they're on model. They'll go back and put a nice clean line, also paying attention to volumes and little subtle animation things that the animator puts in. I make the appropriate changes without changing the animator's original animation.
Yeah, keep a stiff upper lip. They all come in with a whimper and leave with a grin.
The character animator animates only the character. The effects animator animates everything else.
Whoa!
And fire.
Hey, what about water? Can they do water?
Well, effects animation, I would describe it as sort of a supporting role for the character animation. It's our job to create an environment other than the background painting or the layout, to bring a sense of nature, a sense of realism into the scene to make the scene more believable. Even if you're dealing with cartoon characters, you need that edge of reality that brings the audience into a state of believability, saying, gee, that seems so real. It's a way to bring the audience into the environment. In the Little Mermaid bubbles, for example, you're not watching the bubbles, you're watching the characters. But the bubbles are there to make you believe they're underwater. Of course, fish swimming underwater don't even make bubbles in real life. And besides bubbles, sometimes snow's called for.
Snow's a fun attack, but water's fun too.
But one of the most fun things to do is electricity. And electrocution is always nice. In Roller Coaster Rabbit, there's a great scene where Roger accidentally gets into the shooting gallery.
Okay, fellas, fire away!
That's what sets our animation apart from all the rest. Effects, animation.
Another very important kind of effects animation is computer animation. This allows the effects artist to animate very complicated three-dimensional props combined with traditional character animation. In these types of scenes, the computer work is done first, working closely with the character animator, who will later use the computer drawings as a guide when they animate the character.
To model an object inside the computer can take quite a long time, a lot longer than just maybe drawing it by hand. A prop like the roller coaster, we use it over and over and over and over again in lots of different scenes. Then we model it once, and we've got it for all the rest of the scenes.
This computer animation system allows us to describe objects in a three-dimensional environment. We can build any object that we like, any object that exists in the real world, or any object we can think of that doesn't really exist. Once we have these objects built, we'll put them into an animation environment, which we have here. Everything that's in here is made up of different objects. This car, the green part, is an object. The two wheels are two separate objects, and they can all move independently. They can perform animation functions like rotating, squashing, and stretching that conventional character animation does. But our advantage is that we can move it around very quickly, change camera angles wildly, make it very repeatable, and make it very interactive. We can set something up and look at it very quickly.
And there was one box of darts that slide down a shelf. I animated the scene by hand, but there was so much detail that we thought maybe we could clean this up in the computer when you see the box slide down the shelf and everything turning in perspective, and it's all really perfect.
Well, the first thing we do is to build the objects, to sculpt the objects on the computer. And what I've done here is I've sculpted a dart. And so I can take a look at that dart, I can go closer to it, I can rotate around the dart and see it from different angles. It's like shooting things in live action. Whereas on a live action set, if you were to pick up a dart and look at it from different angles, you can see it from the different angles. Here, we can't actually touch it, but what we can do is manipulate it so that we can see it from different angles. That way we don't have to redraw it at any time. The computer knows what the object looks like from any given angle. This scene consisted of approximately 20 darts and one dart box. So I would take the single dart that I had manufactured in the computer, and I make copies of it. I put all 20 darts in the box and then animated the box relative to some computerized camera position.
It's sort of a new art form in animation, is combining computer-generated graphics, backgrounds, layouts moving, props moving, with the characters. It was the roller coaster that actually gave you the force, and the character reacted to that force. When the roller coaster would swing back and forth and rock side to side, the character would follow that.
When setting up a scene like this, it's very important to consider that characters are going to be put into the scene. The character animator will take this drawing that we've provided for them, place it onto a disc, an animation disc, and animate the characters on top of this based on the action that we've provided them. So for each frame of film, they'll have this drawing and another sheet that has their character animation on top of it. We always have to remember that these are made to accentuate the character animation.
The roller coaster itself, the track that's underneath it, all of that was very complex as far as changes in perspective. The camera was always moving, the cars were rolling along the tracks, so everything was in constant motion. And these are objects that are difficult to draw by hand in the first place, but when they start moving, then it's even more complex. So by building them and animating them on the computer, it saved us a lot of time and headache.
The objects in this animation program are run through a plot program. The plotter describes this image onto a paper, and from there it is taken to ink and paint, Xeroxed onto a cell, and painted conventionally as conventional character animation.
I'm just wondering what we're going to be doing in the future, because it doesn't seem to be any end to what we can do with that technology.
The final pencil test is shot to determine if the character and effects animation are working together. But before the scene can go to the background department, the layout department must first make a cleaned-up layout drawing. This final layout will indicate the correct size and location of everything that will be painted in the final background.
Hey, background guy, can you paint me too?
Background artists paint the actual background setting, which the character is shot on a clear acetate on over top of the background. Well, example is this. This character is painted on a separate level, and he's put in over top. A lot of styles that we get into with background paintings have to fit the character's style. The palette for Roger was decided by the type of story that was being told. We decided that it was 12 o'clock noon, it was a fair, there was a lot of festive color. We wanted it bright and happy. It was going to be a real quick-moving, happy film, a lot of action. So we wanted the colors to echo that feeling. Color is very difficult, especially in a carnival. Because you can get real busy on you. For example, this scene here, if you don't pick your colors correctly, it'll really interfere with the character, and the character will just get lost. So we have to make sure that the colors that we pick are of different value and not interfering with being the same color as Roger's hand, for example. If the sun was as bright as his hand, and your eye would get confused on where to go. So everything is like toned down a bit so that the character stands out.
When we're doing a film, we have the key scenes would be more important backgrounds. And then we have the scenes that would come along later, the close-ups, the match shots. This is a key scene. Off of this, the layout artist will take an area within this grid right here, and he would say, okay, I want to use that as a close-up, and Roger's going to be there.
Let us the guys to tie your balloon up, and that way you'll never lose it.
We wanted to create a style, so we started experimenting with different types of paintings, and these are two separate little paintings that we did to try and find a style. This one being more of a transparent style, and this one being more of an opaque style. We decided that this is the way we wanted to go, so this style got put to the side, and we started painting towards this type of look. This is the final background. This is what it looked like. In this particular scene, you see that this is a larger version of the bowl. What happens is the camera pans over to the bowl, and then you zoom in real fast. It's called a match cut. You zoom in real fast, but because this is such a small painting, if you went in on this artwork, you get a lot of breakup. You start seeing all the grain of the paper. So what we have to do is paint this exact same background, you know, try and match it perfectly, but paint a little finer and bigger. So when the camera does pull in, you take this background away and you replace it with this background. So you're actually seeing this one in the final, but you'll never notice that you actually did switch backgrounds.
In this scene, Baby comes flying in here, bounces, and loses the balloon, and the balloon goes way up in the air and floats over to the bull ring, which is a different area. So we want to get the feeling that you're going into a different area and the balloon is floating way up in the air. So by doing this, we decided to go with a layout that's angled this way, which may look strange, but when you see it on the camera, it's going to look completely convincing. All you're actually seeing is Baby comes flying through here, lands, comes from a little speck, lands right here, bounces, loses the balloon, your camera follows up, you feel like you're in the sky, the balloon's floating along, and then it slowly starts coming down, and you catch hint of where the bull is, and there's a bull right here, and this is the bull ring, and the balloon floats right over to where the bull is.
With the backgrounds and animation drawings completed, the film's still only half done. But before we can send all the material to be transferred and painted on cells, each drawing must be checked one by one for consistency. This important process is called animation check. The animation checker scrutinizes every drawing for continuity and line detail and areas to be painted. Also, each drawing must be accounted for against the X sheet, and all camera moves are reviewed.
We're now approximately halfway through the tour. What has taken a few minutes for our guests to experience Story, layout, animation, computer animation, cleanup, special effects, and backgrounds has in fact taken our artists many months to create. We're now in the ink and paint department, where the paint is applied to the cells. I think it's here, for many of our guests, where the artwork really comes alive.
I'd like to introduce you to Fran Kirsten, whose department is responsible for transforming the pencil animation drawings into the final colour cells that will eventually make it onto the screen.
We currently have 20 people in the ink and paint department, which includes Xerox camera. All of these people have some artistic background. Our primary job is to supply all of the artwork that the camera department will need to shoot the final film. The type of work we do involves developing the color models, which determine what colors to mix and paint for each scene. Then the painting of all the character cells. It also includes any special effects like shadows, mattes, airbrush or dry brush, and the final checking process, which makes sure everything is accounted for before being sent to the camera department. But before we can paint a cell, the character has to be transferred to an acetate called a cell. And that takes place here in the Xerox department.
This is the fine platinum room, where each drawing is placed on the platinum, and it's focused into the camera room. Now, let me show you the dark room. Come on, follow me. In order for me to explain how this camera functions, I do have to have the lights off. Okay, from this box, I have 8 plates, which I need to feed through this charging machine. I now take the plate and I press the button, put it onto the camera platen, turn this thing, I'm not sure what this does. Then lock it down with this air. The plate is now locked into place. Close the platen, shut it closed and lock it. Press this button down here, which is right here, and it triggers the lens to open up. Once the image is on the plate, I send it out to the transfer room.
The plate with the image comes out on a conveyor belt into the transfer room. The first thing we do is wipe off any excess toner, being careful not to damage the image itself. Then the plate, along with a blank cell, are placed together on the registration pegs onto the transfer table. There, an electric charge transfers the image from the plate to the cell. But the image is not permanent until we treat the cell with a chemical vapor on the fuser table. Now the image is fused to the cell. Once all of the cells have been transferred, the entire scene will then go to the Xerox check area. There they are checked one by one, comparing the image on the cell to the original pencil drawing. We want to make sure the position of the image on the cell or registration is correct and that the entire image has transferred intact. Any lines that need to be done in a color other than the Xerox line are hand-inked at the Xerox check phase of production. Now that the scene is ready to be painted, it will be distributed to as many as 11 painters. Each of them will have a color model, which indicates what the different colors are and in what area they are to be painted. Just like the animators and their cleanup artists have model sheets as a guide to how the characters should be drawn, the painters have color models to guide how the cells should be painted. The color models usually will be done before a scene reaches ink and paint. Here we have a color model, and what we do, we get with the art director and the background artist to make sure that we can see Mom and she doesn't blend right in with the background.
We want to make sure that these colors aren't, these are getting a little close here. Have to be careful.
We can sometimes make 10 models and they're still not happy, but we go back and eventually we get that.
So you stay here and watch Baby Herman.
No, not that! Anything but that!
Once we determine our color models, we mix all of the paint for the entire scene, making sure we mix enough so we don't run out of paint in the middle of the scene. This is where we mix our paints here. As you can see, we have Mum's nail polish color, and we have a glove shadow. He does look quite simple, but he has 13, 14 colors on here.
Okay, anything you say, Mama Dearest. Why, you know me.
For instance, a scene in Roller Coaster had the darts. There were 75 colors just on the darts alone.
Poke yourself, baby!
All of the artists working with cells wear gloves to keep off fingerprints and any smudging. We paint in a production line process, painting the dark colors first and then building up the lighter colors. We have just finished a 7-minute film, Roller Coaster Rabbit, which approximately had 23,000 cells. Roger was quite difficult. He had 14 colors. Most people could average about 16 cells a day. Although painting looks easy, it takes time to get consistent quality from an artist.
Accuracy is very important, mainly because our characters are so detailed. Because it's a different technique as opposed to, you know, brushing strokes or doing, you know, fine detail. This is applied by a floating process. Actually, you want to kind of puddle it on the cell, which is very different.
Before the artwork leaves the ink and paint department, there is one last responsibility called the final check area. Each piece of art, sometimes as many as a dozen for one frame of film, is carefully reviewed. We inventory all of the art to make sure it's all there and to catch any quality control problem that may have crept in.
Basically, what I'm doing is looking for any problems. I use the same exposure sheet the cameraman will use, because what I'm doing is a dry run of camera, how the camera will actually see it. Scene 25 from Roller Coaster Rabbit's a good example. There are 7 levels in this scene. The background always goes down first. The first level that goes down is a level of shadows for the props. They look black on here, but the camera shoots them at a percentage. These are the props that the shadows go to. And then on top of that, there's another level of props that animate separately from the first level. The next thing is the character shadow, and then his body goes down without a head on it because his body's not moving. And then his head goes down. I have to make sure his head sits on his body just right. Now his head's on a separate level here because that's the only thing that's moving. This is the last level. It's the guns that are getting ready to shoot at him.
We like everybody to be multi-talented because it is very important that it's teamwork here. And when we get very, very busy and down to the crunch, that everybody can help each other.
With all of the artwork now completed, it's time for the technology to take over and work some of its magic in both the camera and the editorial departments.
Cut! Print! Ha ha!
Camera department here at Disney's made up of 2 cameras, 2 operators. The cameras are motion control, meaning they're more like big robots. In Disney animation, they use more care and really more detail than any other animation I've ever seen. They animate even the minute details, yeah, which is really impressive.
Camera department at Disney is a wonderful place. This is where we make the magic happen. We take what the animators have done, add moves to it, add special effects, and put it up on film.
All camera involves a certain degree of complexity. The operator has to really stay tuned to his scene and his work. All it takes is one simple mistake to trash a day's work.
The animators make the motion, but we have to add camera movements and special effects. It's called scene planning. In the cartoon Roller Coaster Rabbit, we have scene 47.1. In that scene, we start off on Baby. He is moving at a certain amount of time. I have to scene plan so that we're on Baby the whole time. First, we had the layout down, showing what's going to be in the background. Then they give us a start and stop position, showing us where the character is going to be at all times. To make sure where we are, we have a rack over unit, which will focus down through the lens, and we will be able to see exactly what the camera is seeing. Roller Coaster Rabbit, nothing stays still. We have camera shakes, we have panning, we have zooms coming back. The scene planning in it is going in just about every frame.
The guests in the tour corridor don't really bother me here until it comes down to the flash photography. Yeah. A single flash can give us a hot frame in the middle of our motion here and actually cause us a day to 3 days' work.
So every time there's a change in the reel, whether it's one frame or taking out a whole storyboard idea, it's an editorial that we have to keep that up to date so that the director, the producer, the animators can come down and get an idea of how their scene fits into the whole picture. In animation, you're getting the film at various stages. You get it at the initial storyboard stage, and then you get it in the rough stage, the cleanup, and the color stage, and you're constantly putting it in and updating the reel. So it's an evolution. It's an organic process. The film starts at a storyboard stage and then grows into something else.
Everything is done primarily on film. The video complements the film. With the video equipment, we're able to see our results immediately. It saves a lot of time, and camera department and animators use this a lot so that they are able to stay on top of the scene and meet deadlines.
The sound is something that's often overlooked by most people, but it's a very, very important part of the picture, and it's a very important part of what we do here in editorial. Sound effects in an animated film don't exist. So every sound, every of a foot, is added to the film in editorial. And the other thing that's important about sound is the sync of a film, so that you have that believability that the character is really talking, that the mouth is matching at the right time. When all the color's done, we're the last ones to get our hands on it and put the sound effects and the music and the dialogue back with it and do a final mix on the show.
With that, the film is now finished. Our work is done. All of our decisions have been made. Everything we tried to accomplish is wrapped up on a reel of film. Now it's time for the audience to see that accomplishment.
Go back 15 months, go back 18 months, when this was just a shell and it was a construction site and we were planning to attract top quality artists to come and work here. I suppose in our wildest dreams we hoped that we would have a studio that would be producing top quality animation. I can say now, later and in hindsight, that yes, I think we've definitely achieved that. We've got a fabulous crew here. If we had tried to approach this attraction, let's call it an attraction, because from the guest's point of view, that's what it is. If we had approached it as an attraction, it would have somehow seemed hollow to the guests as they came through it. It had to be a real working studio, both for their experience and, of course, for the artist. How do you get the very finest artists to come and work and relocate to Central Florida if it's going to be a sham? So it had to be real. It had to be an actual working studio. This studio could become famous in two ways. One, because it's an attraction which many thousands of people visit when they come to Central Florida. And secondly, it could be because of the artwork or the films that we produce here. And I hope that really that it'll be both, obviously working in two different ways. I think for many of the guests who come through here, they're experiencing our films being made. When those films are released, I hope they'll be eager to go and see them and say, well, I experienced this film in the making. My role here as director of operations is to be in charge of the entire studio. I have several people that report to me and actually keep the studio running. One of those people is Tim O'Donnell, who's our production manager. His responsibilities are the production flow of the films that we're actually making. Tad Gilo, who's our manager of technologies, is responsible for all the computer equipment. I once described his job to him to try and simplify it for everybody. I once said that Tad's job responsibility could be described that if it has a plug on it, it falls within Tad's department.
It's my job to keep all of our technical equipment, be it computer graphics or production cameras or editorial equipment, up and running, and also being looking out as into the new frontiers of technology and see how they can be applied to the animation process.
Coming into the containment pose and easing in, they'll recoil it in.
Frank Gladstone, native of Miami, Florida, heads up our training department.
What happens in the animation training program here at Walt Disney is we bring talented people, mostly from an illustrative background, from art schools around the country, and they come here on the strength of their portfolios, and we try and teach them how to draw for animation.
Darryl Brown, our production auditor, of course, is responsible for all of the dollars that we spend here.
In animation, we start with the quotas that the animators are capable of doing. From that, we extend it for the number of people that's required to do the cleanup, as well as all the different steps that come after that.
A very important person in the studio for the smooth day-to-day running is Janet McLaurin, who is in charge of all our supplies and materials that our artists use.
This is the main storeroom, one of several in the building, but this is the storeroom that the bulk of this inventory comes into when it's ordered. We use a lot of paper, a lot of cell acetate, many, many different pencils. We have a lot of supplies here for the ink and paint department, including gloves for everyone.
Imagine a world beneath the sea.
We also have a special projects unit, which is headed up by Paul Carossi.
In the past, there has been a lot of commercials and things that highlight Disney feature characters. Because of the workload that we've had in the studios, we've never been able to do the animation, and they've always had to be farmed out to other animation studios. So the idea of a special projects unit, it'll monitor and coordinate the production of national campaigns that have the Disney feature animated characters on there.
Look, it's us! Wow! Makes a good impression!
We're a satellite of our studio in California. Animation traditionally has been done at our studios there. It was where the studio first started. And so the studio down here can be seen as a satellite of that studio. We report directly back to people there. In fact, my boss is Peter Schneider, who's senior vice president of Disney Animation. So on a daily basis, probably 90% of the contact that I have in terms of how we're doing down here is back to California.
I've been with Disney for 10 years.
18 and a half years.
1 year and 1 week.
8 months.
My 15th year. It's
been 8 years.
About a month now.
I went to an art college.
My parents sort of pushed me into it.
Well, I grew up in a theater environment.
I was a commercial artist.
I did some freelance work in Los Angeles.
Went to a film school for a while.
I like working out here with all the people coming by.
The biggest distraction? Tapping on the window.
Everybody's watching and you look up and they all clap.
Tap on the glass.
You're oblivious to the fact that you're being watched.
The fishbowl.
Most people like it.
Check out who's up there.
Living wallpaper.
I've moved away from the glass now, so it doesn't bother me anymore.
When they wave, you say, I hate that.
The difference in Disney animation really is the attention to infinite detail.
They do not take any shortcuts at all.
The way it moves.
Quality.
Good entertainment.
They're not afraid to do it right here.
It's part of the legacy, just the quality of the work.
Beautiful colors.
The personalities of the characters.
I think all the neat people who work here.
That there's nothing like Disney animation.
This is the reassembly area. It's a pre-show for Theater 2, but it's also a very important experience for the guests. It's here that they get an opportunity to meet the personalities behind the animators. Our guests to this point have been able to observe the animators at work, but it's here that we've interviewed many of those artists, and then they're telling stories about their experiences at Disney. We hope that during the experience that the guests have, that one day we'll find a young animator who will say, You know, I got my start in Disney animation when I came through these tour corridors. At the moment, many of our artists have gained their inspiration as being a young child experiencing perhaps Pinocchio or Snow White. But here, in these corridors, we could perhaps create the next generation of Disney animators through the inspiration that they'll get by seeing our artists at work.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are.
Theatre 2, the Disney Classics Theatre. The last stop for our guests on their tour of animation, where we screen a film depicting some classic moments from over 60 years of Disney animated films. Perhaps one day, some of the work that we create here at this studio will be considered a classic and therefore be included in this film. Now that our guests have completed their tour of animation, they exit the building through the merchandising shop. This is an opportunity for them to purchase items from artwork that they've seen in the lobby as they enter the building and take away with them unique souvenirs from the art of Disney animation.
Most of the artwork for the merchandise in the gallery comes from original animation exhibited in the lobby at the beginning of the tour. There is a wide variety of animation merchandise, from note cards to actual art used in the production of Disney animated films. We have a very large selection of cells, which is the most collectible item of animation. There are three types of cells that we carry: a production cell, a reproduction cell, which is a limited edition, and a commemorative cell. A production cell is an original piece of artwork that was created and photographed for a Disney animated film, either for feature or television. For instance, here's a production cell that became an actual frame in the film Who Framed Roger Rabbit. There is only one of these cells that exist. A limited edition cell is a reproduction of a cell from an animated film. The particular cell was not used in the original production of the film. However, the image that is transferred to the limited edition cell did come from an original animation pencil drawing that was created for a film. In most cases, cells from the classic animated films no longer exist, but many of the drawings do. And so the cells are transferred from the original drawings either by Xeroxing or hand inking. The number of pieces reproduced in a limited edition will usually range from 250 to 500. They are then painted to match as closely as possible the original production colors. Each cell is numbered when they are reproduced, with two sets of numbers appearing at the bottom left-hand corner, separated by a slash. The first indicates what number the individual cell is relative to the overall number of reproductions. The second indicates the total number of cells that were reproduced. There is no difference in value between a high number or a low number. The quality should be the same throughout. The third type of cell is called a commemorative cell. The image on the cell has nothing to do with the production of an animated film, rather just a piece of character art that has been drawn for a special commemorative series. In this case, it is the logo of the Walt Disney Animation Florida Studios. The image is transferred to a cell and then hand-painted the same way a production or limited edition reproduction cell would be. But unlike the limited edition cell, there is no set quantity that will be produced. In addition to the limited edition cells, there are also limited edition lithographs. The artwork for these are taken from the original production backgrounds, sometimes combined with cells, then photographed and printed in a high-quality lithographic four-color process. This image is printed on a very high-quality acid-free paper, which means that it will not deteriorate over the years. Great care is taken to match to the original colors as accurately as possible. Like all limited editions, the numbers at the bottom indicate the number of the total run and number of that reproduction. Throughout the gallery, there are many other different types of merchandise: posters, sculptures, books, tapes, and records that relate to animation. This one-of-a-kind animation shop helps to complement the animation experience throughout the animation tour. There are many parts of the guest animation experience all rolled up into one building. From a traditional sense, there is the lobby, which displays the original artwork that represents many different styles used in our films throughout the years. Then later, in Theatre 2, the Disney Classics Theatre, guests can again experience how the art was brought to life in some of the great scenes from Disney animated classics. There is the Walter Cronkite Robin Williams film in Theatre 1, which gives each guest, regardless of their knowledge of animation, a common understanding to experience the animation production tour. Then there is the actual production tour corridor, where we show skilled artists and technicians at work creating a Disney animated film. Here, guests can experience the present as well as glance into the future of Disney animation. In the assembly area outside Theatre 2, we meet some of the Disney artists on screen as they express what their role in animation means to them. And in the gallery, we give the guests an opportunity to bring home some of the magic of Disney animation.
Well, it's no longer dawn. It's now some 4 or 5 hours later, and that completes your tour of everything about Disney animation. So now, you're the experts. Or are you? Perhaps this is just the beginning now. Perhaps this is the starting point for you to now know more about the animation process. Because if you can become the experts, just think what a fantastic experience the guests are going to have when they visit the magic of Disney animation.